Greetings and welcome back to the second video of Lesson 8, Level 1. In this video, we'll go over the details of a one-variable data table. Here's an example of a one-variable data table that illustrates how revenue, expenses, and operating income vary as the number of units sold increases from 500 to 3,000. Pertaining to the TZ Swimskin product that we discussed in the previous video, let's look at how we came to these projections on this spreadsheet model similar to the one that we worked on back in Lesson 6. At this point, we're being told by the sales department that they expect to sell about 3,000 units at a projected selling price of just under $130 per unit. These expectations can only be expected if an aggressive marketing plan was implemented, and the cost of this plan would be about $75,000. We also know that the cost of goods sold is going to be $75.75 per unit, and there will also be a per unit charge for distribution and shipping of $5 per unit. The total payroll expenses will be $52,000, and the estimated overhead associated with the project will be $18,000. For now, we'll ignore corporate income tax, since that will introduce another level of estimates into analysis that's already full of best guesses, and since taxes are calculated on the overall profitability of the entire company, it doesn't seem appropriate that we add them here. As you can see, the worksheet is divided into two different areas. This assumptions area on the left contains all of the assumptions that we expect surrounding this project. The projections area on the right contains all of the calculations and formulas that calculate such variable revenues and expense such as sales revenue, cost of goods sold, gross profit, distribution expenses, and contribution margin. A contribution margin is calculated by subtracting all variable expenses from the sales in order to determine how much money we have to offset our fixed expenses, and are very common when we need to evaluate the profitability of sales alternatives and when performing break-even analyses. Down here, it calculates all of our fixed expenses. And finally, we have our bottom line of marginal income before taxes, or sometimes referred to as marginal pre-tax income. To quickly demonstrate these formulas, if I hit the Control tilde keys, we can see that the sales is just units sold multiplied by the selling price per unit. The cost of goods sold is the units sold multiplied by the cost per unit. Notice that in this formula, I vary from the book a little bit as I multiply the formula by a negative 1 by adding a negative sign here in front of the formula. This way, my model more accurately shows which values are positive numbers and which ones are negative numbers. The gross profit is now the sum of these two calculated values. The distribution expense will again be a negative number, which is the units sold multiplied by the distribution cost per unit. And then the contribution margin is just the sum of the gross profits and all the other variable expenses. Our fixed expenses are just the marketing plan, payroll, and overhead. Again, these values are all negative, so we put a negative sign in front of our cell references, and then we add them up here in this cell. Finally, the marginal income before taxes here is the contribution margin added to the total fixed expenses. The projection sheet shows that if all assumptions and estimates are correct, the TZ Swimskin profits will increase the profitability of the company by a measly $2,600. That's not horrible for a new product line, I suppose, but what if the sales department made a mistake in their sales estimates? What if the projections were based on a new unit sales amount of 1,500 units instead of the 3,000 currently in this cell? If I overwrite the 3,000 by putting 1,500 here, our marginal pre-tax income drops to a negative $71,200. Ouch! We could conduct our own ad hoc what-if analysis by putting in different values and then using all of our awesome formulas here on this projection side to determine our marginal pre-tax income, and then writing down each individual one over here like this. Looks like 2,500 has me losing this amount, so I'll copy and do a paste special value here. Ugh, that's all very cumbersome and kind of disorganized. I've also seen folks put in a value here and then print off this page 10 times for 10 different values and then sort them. Yikes! As you've heard me say before, life is too short for that kind of manual effort, so we need a way to automate that and save us a boatload of time. Enter the data table. In one simple step, we can automate all of this to conduct many analyses and see a simple summary of the results on this worksheet. To create a data table, about the only rule is that you need to create it on the same worksheet that your assumptions and your formulas rest. To set up the structure of the data table, we need to set up the set of input values that we want to feed into our what-if analysis. In a one-variable data table, we'll delete this garbage here and then recreate it from scratch. Let's say that I want to see the marginal pre-tax income if I change the unit sales amount to 10 different values. If our units sold varies from 500 to 5,000 in increments of 500 units, I'll start by typing in a 500 here, and then 1,000 right underneath it, and then by using Chapter 1 shortcut we learned way back when, I'll drag this fill handle down until I get to 5,000. These values in this column will be the input into this unit sales cell, right? Okay, that's step one. Next, for step two, the outputs that we want the results for each of these input values are the values in these cells here. I'll make them a different color for now just to illustrate our point. I want the sales projection, the gross profit, the contribution margin, and the marginal income before taxes. For each of those cells, I'll go up here one row up and one cell to the right of our unit sales amounts, and then have these four cells mapped to each of the output cells that we want to track. This cell equals this cell, this cell equals this cell, equals this cell, equals this cell. There we go. These cells now contain the values from these cells, but they aren't very descriptive, are they? If someone else looks at this page, they'll end up getting confused about, well, what are these values here? If we remember back in Chapter 2, we briefly played with some custom formatting. Let's build on that a bit here to aid in the look and readability of our data table. If we right-click on this first sales revenue column header and select Format Cells here, and then select Custom. Now here are a bunch of custom ones, but we just want this cell to always display just the text sales revenue. So I'll put in double quotes, sales revenue, double quotes, and then a semicolon. I'll need to repeat this sales revenue in double quotes because this custom formatting allows you to have different formats for positive values, a different one for negative values, a different one for zero, and a different format for text. The value rendered by my awesome formula will never be text, so I just need to tell Excel what to show for positive, negative, and zero values. So I repeat this double quote, sales revenue double quote, two more times, separated by semicolons, and there you go. So even though this formula renders the value from this cell, it actually shows you this beautiful and ever so elegant text. I'll repeat this part for these cells offline to save us a little bit of time. Okay, I'm back. Now just to prove to you that these cells actually contain values, I'll highlight them all and then go up here and do a paste special. Values, and there we have these numbers, proving that these cells down here with the custom formatting actually contain numbers, not just that text. Isn't Excel cool? Well, I think it's cool, and it's all about me today, so that's where we'll go. Now that we have the data table structure set up, we can go ahead and complete it. We continue our one variable data table construction by going up to the upper left corner of this grid and selecting all of the cells down to and including the lower right corner cell. Next, we go to the data ribbon and then select What If Analysis. In here, we select, yep, you guessed it, data table. This dialog box pops up. We have input boxes for a row input cell and a column input cell. This is dependent upon whether you are using a row or a column for your input values. In this example, the column holds our input values, right? These values need to be mapped into which assumption cell? This cell here, you say? I'll go with that, so I click in the column input cell and then map this unit sales cell into it by clicking on the cell containing that value. Now I click OK, and Excel runs the data table tool and that instantly calculates all of these output values for all of these different assumption input values. Ta-da! Now that we have this completed, let's add a bit more formatting to make it a bit more legible for others. Let's make all of these values with commas, since they aren't dollars, they're units, and all of these with dollar signs, since they're dollars. I'll put in the text units sold up here in the upper left corner. I'll bold all of these, and I'm generally a fan of cell borders, so I'll do that as well. There, that's a lot prettier, don't you think? I suppose that I could put a title up here as well. Sales, gross profit, contribution margin, and income before taxes given varying number of units sold. Merge and center, bold it, paint this format from this cell to here, and there you go. From this data table, I can easily see the approximate value of our break-even point. It looks like it's somewhere between 2,500 and 3,000 units. If we wanted a bit more detail on what that break-even value is, we could use increments of less than 500. For instance, I could type in 2,500, 2,600, 2,700, 2,800, 2,900, 3,000, just to give me a better idea of where our break-even point is. But for our estimating purposes, this range of results is close enough. So I'll just undo all those and get back to my original 500 units. If you wanted to know the exact break-even point for some reason, we can go up here and use this goal seek to set cell, that's our marginal pre-tax income, to a value of 0 by changing this cell here. Hit OK, and here we have the exact value of our break-even point if we really wanted it. I'm not sure that we do, since a lot of these assumptions are just that, rough assumptions, but it still demonstrates some cool functionality, and I'm all about that. So I'll do it just the same. Reviewing, a one-variable data table allows us to vary one input assumption value, but it can display multiple output cells. We can also use this data table to conduct another type of what-if scenario, the dreaded sensitivity analysis. All of these cells in our data table contain values that continuously recalculate themselves based upon the current values in our business model over here on the left. For instance, if we want to see how sensitive our various outputs are to a change in an assumption, say our cost of producing a swim skin, we can just change that value from the original estimate of $75.75 to $95. The data table automatically recalculates, and we can easily see how that affects all of these output results. Our break-even point is now down here between 4,500 and 5,000. We can change different items in our assumptions to see how all these changes alter our various outputs as well. From this example, we can see that our marginal pre-tax income is fairly sensitive to changes in cost of goods sold, and that makes sense since every dollar that our costs rise will directly influence how much money we make. This is all very useful information for our managerial team to consider when deciding whether or not to continue plans for the TZ Swimskin product line. In our next video, we'll discuss ways in which to perform a what-if analysis by varying two values at the same time in, yes, you guessed it, a two-variable data table. See you in the next video.